polymeters, polyrhythms, pollywogs? These are strange things, right? Wrong! They're our friends! Well, at least when we take the time to get to know them. So on that note, please allow me to introduce my friends to you. But first, tea. Ray Harmony here, and welcome to the Hack Music Theory Revolution, where we empower you with notation-free theory for making great music. So, two things aligned, which resulted in this lesson right here. The first thing was that last week I did a video on a bass line that I wrote using a polymeter. By the way, thank you so much for all your kind comments about the video. What's interesting though is that something turned up in the comments and people were emailing in asking, what's the difference between a polymeter and a polyrhythm? It turns out there's an immense amount of confusion and even misinformation around these two concepts on the internet. But that all ends right here, right now, with this video. The second thing that aligned, resulting in this lesson, is that we just binge-watched Stranger Things 2. And the soundtrack is full of these pulsating synths that just go and go and go and cause tension. And I was thinking the whole way through, that's the perfect foundation to teach what a polymeter and a polyrhythm is and the difference, because it's so easy to hear them against that pulsating synth. So there you go, two things that made this lesson. All right, let's jump in. So our BPM is 90, our time signature is 4/4, and we're in the key of A minor. So that's just all the white notes with A as the root. So in other words, the home. This video is not about chord progressions though. So I'm just gonna kind of blast through here real quick and give you an overview of our chords. So we've got A minor, we've got C major, we've got E minor, and then we're finishing on G major. If you want some help writing chord progressions and arranging the notes in a way like we've done here so the chords flow smoothly into each other, then please check out my Hack Music Theory for Songwriting and Producing PDF. The link is below. And this is what it sounds like. Alright, now that we got our Stranger Things inspired pulsating synths all set up and ready to go, let's start by clearing up any and all confusion with regards to the terms. This is so easy, are you gonna laugh? Are you ready? So, a polymeter. Poly means two or more, meter means time signature. Therefore, a polymeter is two or more time signatures playing simultaneously. Now, a polyrhythm. Poly means two or more. Rhythm means a pattern in time. Therefore, a polyrhythm is two or more patterns in time playing simultaneously. It's that easy. Now, having said that, there are countless ways to creatively interpret and express these two musical concepts. So in this video, I'm just going to teach you one of each to get you started. All right, let's do this. Okay, so here's how this game works. We're going to write two versions of the same melody, one using a polymeter and one using a polyrhythm. And then we're going to play them back to back so you can really hear the difference between a polymeter and a polyrhythm. And then also, please note that we've got the root notes for the chords in our progression down here. These are all muted, so they're just there to act as a template over which we can write our melody. And we're going to start with a polymeter, two or more time signatures playing simultaneously. And because we've already got our chords and our bass synth and our drums going in 4/4, all we need to do now is choose a time signature for our lead melody. When choosing your second time signature, start by changing the grid to whatever note value you want for that time signature. So you could do it in quarter notes, in eighth notes, in 16th notes, 30 seconds, whatever you want. I'm going to use eighth notes because the number eight is very special in Stranger Things 2. So then what you have to do is, once you've selected the note value, you need to decide how many beats you want to designate to that second time signature. So in other words, how many beats are we going to use to write our lead melody now? And I'm obviously going to use 11. If you've watched Stranger Things 2, you know 11 and 8, those are magic numbers, right? So anyway, if you haven't watched it, there's two characters called 11 and 8. Inevitable tattoos. Yeah, tattoos. It's very cool. Okay, so what we're going to do is write our second melody in 11/8. What that means is we're going to have 11 eighth notes. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. So that is going to be one bar of 11/8, and then that is going to loop. So this melody is going to loop. And when it comes to looping that second time signature in a polymeter, there's a couple different ways to do it. You could let them both just kind of go and do their thing. So they kind of start together on the one, and then they go in different directions, and then eventually they'll align again where both of their first beats come together. That's one way to do it. Sometimes you can go on for a very long time until they eventually align again. The other way to do it is to go as long as you want and then just cut that second time signature. And that's exactly what we're going to do here. So we've already got our chord progression going in four bars of 4/4. This makes it a very neat and satisfying sounding chord progression. It's very even sounding. So all we're going to do is we're going to loop this 11/8 time signature as many times as we can. And then it's just going to get cut at the end here. Whatever doesn't fit, doesn't fit. We just start again. Okay, and now we use these 11 eighth notes to write our melody. So let's start. We're gonna start on B. We're going to go up to C. Then we're going to come down to E. Then we're going to go up to D, down to C, and then an octave lower over the C, up to B, and then down to a D, and then up to another B. And then we're going to end on two A, so that's the root, and we're going to actually glue those together, so those two eighth notes become a quarter note. So you're really going to be able to hear where that melody ends, and therefore where that time signature ends. Okay, now that we have written our melody, it's time to loop it. So we select all the MIDI, and here we go. This is our second loop, and check this out. When we try for the third loop, look what happens. Wow, it's too long. But how amazing is this? Because we're ending on that quarter note on the A, which is the root note of our scale, we can just cut it to an eighth note, and it doesn't even change the melody because the melody still ends on A. It's just that A is a bit shorter than it was previously. So once we've cut that, we can now just select that last loop through the melody and move it into place, and now we're done. So we're getting 11/8, 11/8, and then the last 11/8 has been chopped to 10/8. Okay, let's have a listen to our polymeter. And as it plays through, I really want you to pay attention to the first beats of the bar in both of those different time signatures. So we're gonna hear the first beat of the bar in 4/4 over there, and then over there, and then over there, and then over there. So we're gonna get four beat ones in our 4/4 time signature, but then in the 11/8 one, we're only gonna get three. So we're gonna get our first beat of the bar there, and then this is the beginning of our next bar of 11/8, and then that last bar is not even 11/8, that's 10/8. Okay, so we're only gonna get three first beats in our second time signature. And what you'll notice is on beat one over here, it's the only time that both of the first beats of those time signatures align. The next beat one in 4/4 is here, and then 11/8 is there, and then 4/4 is there, and then that's the 10/8 one there, and then this is the 4/4 one here. So all the other beat ones are totally misaligned, and then boom, it all locks in again at the beginning here. So that is what a polymeter is all about, different first beats of different bars in different time signatures. Here we go, the polymeter, exhibit A. And now onto exhibit B, the polyrhythm. So in other words, two or more patterns in time playing simultaneously. Okay, the easiest way to get a polyrhythm is to change how you subdivide each beat. So you can see right now we have the grid set to eighth straight, which means each quarter note is being divided up into two eighth notes. So we're dividing quarter notes into two. What we could do is change straight to triplet, which means now we're dividing each quarter note into three equal parts, and that is an eighth note triplet each. So we could also change it to quarter note triplets, which means now we're dividing a half note beat into three equal parts instead of a half note into four equal parts. So you can play around with all kinds of different triplets, and that's a really easy way to get a polyrhythm going, because we're going to be in the same time signature. So our lead synth is going to be written using a polyrhythm, but it's still just going to be in 4-4. Everything's in 4-4 here. But because we're dividing the beat up differently, our melody is going to be using triplets, and our chord progression and bass synth and drums, that's all just going to be eighth straight. So we're going to get this incredible kind of rubbing against each other of these two rhythms, but they're both in 4-4. Okay, so we can take the melody as it is and just nudge it a little bit into this new triplet grid here. So we just move all these notes. So we're using quarter note triplets, which I think is going to be really nice to get a little bit of a slower movement through our melody. So we're just moving them all over and then extending them to make sure they fit. Okay, so have a listen to this real quick. This is just an example of the melody shifted into quarter note triplets. Okay, so you can immediately hear that quarter note triplet just rubbing against those straight eighth notes. It's awesome. Okay, so I really enjoyed all of that up to bar two. That kind of felt a little slow because obviously quarter note triplet is longer than, you know, that original melody of just straight eighth notes. So here's another trick. We can actually change the grid to eighth triplets, and we can actually so the second bar we're actually going to go through eighth triplets. This is going to sound awesome, because check this out. What happens is we end up with the same accents. So we're accenting beat two of our 4-4 time signature, which is the snare drum. And we can actually copy and paste this little melodic fragment here. So we're going to get the accents on the two and the four. So we're going to have that's the root note of the scale, so that's A, and those are going to be accentuated with the backbeat snare. So have a listen to this. Okay, now all we do is copy and paste that, because that's two bars of 4-4, and we're going to go into the second half of this. And here's another little trick. Sometimes what is very cool is to take your polyrhythm and unpolyrhythm it, so you actually lock into the same subdivision of the beat, just, you know, in one place somewhere. And I think it's going to be really cool to do that in this fourth bar here, where everything's just going to lock in to the straight eighth notes, and we can use the same melody. So we're actually going to use that exact same thing. So the melody is going to end exactly the same as it always does, except now we're into straight eighth notes, and then we get a really nice long A at the end, which once again is the root note of the scale. So that's pretty cool. Okay, so here we go. Exhibit B, the polyrhythm.
And just before I play the final polymetric version of the melody and polyrhythmic version of the melody back to back, so you can really hear the difference between a polymeter and a polyrhythm, just a quick note to say that if you want to join our hack music theory revolution, then head on over to patreon.com/revolutionharmony. Thanks big time for watching, and we'll see you next Thursday on the Hack Music Theory Show. Until then, happy songwriting and producing.